app service, and in app service API app. So if at all you have been doing web API in ASP.NET MVC, or if you are writing RESTful services in Java, Python, PHP, how can you make these services available to others, I mean other developers, and leverage all the benefits of Azure Cloud? That is what we are going to see in this particular session. Of course, I am going to restrict myself to ASP.NET MVC Web API. But even if you are doing Java or Python or PHP, it's not going to be much different. The concepts are going to remain same. So first thing, what is REST? What is RESTful service? See, before RESTful services, we had SOAP web services, simple object access protocol. Now in SOAP web services, data was exchanged between client and server. Basically, the API and the client application which is using that API, data was exchanged in the form of XML. And that XML also was supposed to be in a specific format, which they called it as SOAP, a new protocol altogether, simple object access protocol. Now, the major drawback of SOAP, or in short XML itself, is the data becomes verbose. That means you have to handle large volume of data. Tags, their attributes, all these things are also part of the network bandwidth. They are also flowing on, it's not just the data. The description of the data through tags and attributes is also part of your input-output. So on devices like mobile, it is not friendly because we don't have a lot of speed on device on mobile kind of devices. So we want on mobile, and not only on mobile now, even desktop, we don't want large volume of data to be exchanged. We want to exchange data in simple format. That is how JSON got evolved. JavaScript object notation, a very simple object notation where we have key value pairs separated in single object. So JSON advantage over XML. JSON is very small when compared to XML in terms of the size. JSON data is much smaller. And we wanted this JSON data to flow over the standard HTTP protocol. So when we have HTTP protocol and so in JSON and HTTP together, what is that which is flowing from client to server and server to client? So every RESTful service request, every RESTful service request will have three things. Will have URL, will have request method. URL is of course the path where the service is located, and the request method is get, post, put, merge, delete. All these are different request methods. So many times what we do is we will develop this as a service, and in this service we will have one method for get operation, one method we will have for post operation, mostly it is add. We will have method for put or merge, which is generally used for editing, and we'll have a method for delete, which is used for deleting, obviously. Get generally is again for two things. One is to get all, and another is to get one, either one record or all records. So like that, we are sending data from browser to server in case of post, put and delete. And in case of get, we are getting data from server to browser, that is client, and that is either in XML or JSON. Most of the time nowadays preferred format is JSON. We are not using XML very often nowadays. I told you my major reason, it is verbose. So if I want to get all employees, my request is going to be framed like this. Demo.com is the server on which HTTP server where my app service web API is loaded, and this is the name of the object which is going to provide the functionality, and as I said earlier, this is going to decide the method of that particular object. And certain times we are going to have some additional data. this data is going to be the parameter to those methods. So we'll have a URL, which is, let us say, a class. We'll have a method based on this HTTP method, and these are parameters of that method. Like that, mapping will be done by our web server. The framework which we are using on server will take care of doing this mapping for us. When we are doing a post from browser to server, we might post extra data like this in JSON format. Extra data will be posted. Like in put, I'm going to post ID and this. Whereas in delete, only ID is sufficient. Browser, remember, supports only post and get. Your HTML forms by default support only get and post. So how do we use all these things? Obviously, we will have to write JavaScript, jQuery, or nowadays Angular code for performing these operations through API. JavaScript API we will use. We'll make an AJAX call to this URL with this request method and with this data. So this is in general about REST. It has nothing to do with web services. It has nothing to do with app services. In general, this is about REST. So what is that we are going to do now? We are actually planning to develop a API app. What is API app? If you go to portal and if you say all services, here you can search for API app, which actually falls under app services only. So under app services, we have got different subcomponents, different other types of services: API app, logic app, web app, mobile app, and now we also have Azure functions. So these are all different things under app services. So now I am more focusing on only API app. What are the benefits of API app? Generally, we will develop API and we keep it as it is and publish it in web in API app. Like for example, I am doing, imagine, ASP.NET MVC web API. Remember, in MVC it is called as web API. This particular web API I am going to deploy as API app. Now you have to understand these two terms. Web API is MVC.NET specific. API app is in Azure, part of app service, the platform as a service, which gives us ready-made ability to host our API. So API app is in Azure. Web API is in .NET MVC. API app need not be ASP.NET MVC web API. It can be even Java web API. It can be Node.js web API. It can be Python or PHP web API also. Beautiful thing is, once I host my web API as API app, I do not have to make any changes to the existing API. As a developer, with zero changes, we can host it as web API. I mean, we can host a web API as API app. And equally same thing is possible even for Java, PHP, Python, and Node.js. We are going to have Swagger metadata generated for our web API. Now, what is this Swagger metadata? I'll talk more about it a little later. But Swagger metadata is going to provide us the list of API methods and their parameters. In other terms, it is a documentation which both humans and computers can use for understanding the functionalities provided by the API. So we have to enable Swagger metadata for our web API before hosting it in API app, so that the Swagger metadata can be used by others like Java for consuming my API app. So Java using Swagger can consume API app, which is actually a web API in .NET. So interoperability becomes very easy because of the API apps there. We get simple access control, security feature with zero lines of code. You can make your API secured just by enabling security. One click, you can deny access to anonymous user, and then few more clicks, you can probably integrate your API with the single sign-on feature supported by the identity providers like Azure AD or Google or Microsoft or Facebook or Twitter. So simple access control with that restriction also will become available to us. Automatic SDK generation. See, writing RESTful client is not so easy. You have to use a lot of HTTP calls. You'll have to do a lot of string handling. And I may not like doing that. Even my objects are in JSON format, which is actually string. I want to work as a C-sharp developer in C-sharp. I want to use C-sharp classes. I want to have something which is as simple as creating an object of a class and calling a method of it. Web API provides you an ability where you can create a SDK out of Web API using its Swagger metadata. In other words, if I'm a Java programmer, I can get Java classes created from the Web API, API app. If I'm a .NET programmer, on a wrapper of API app, C-sharp classes can be generated. So I can use these simple classes in my applications, which can be mobile applications, web application, desktop application. It can be any type of application. It can easily program because of the SDK, which is generatable. Very good integration with Visual Studio. You can easily do deployment, debugging. All that can be pretty much done through Visual Studio. And finally, if at all you are doing logic app, the best way to put your custom code in a logic app is through API app. We develop a web API where we write our custom code, maybe communicate with database or whatever, and put that in API app and eventually use that API app in a logic app. So these are some basic introduction to web API. The next thing we need to see is how to actually develop a web API and host it as API app.